أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين نحمده ونسبحه ونقدسه على آلائه ونعمائه ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له إلها واحدا أحدا فردا صمدا قيوما نؤمن له بالربوبية ونقر له بالعبودية من يهدي الله فهو المهتدي ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا ونشهد أن سيدنا محمدا عبده ورسوله اللهم صل على أرسله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله اللهم صل وسلم وبارك وترحم على محمد وآل محمد كأفضل ما صليت وسلمت وباركت وترحمت على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد وصل اللهم وسلم على أوصيائه وخلفائه وأهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين وعلى من تبعهم بإحسان وإيمان إلى قيام يوم الدين عباد الله أوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله عز وجل ولزوم أمره قال الله تعالى في محكم كتابه الكريم أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ادعو إلى سبيل ربك بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة وجادلهم بالتي هي أحسن إن ربك هو أعلم بمن ضل عن سبيله وهو أعلم بالمهتدين آمنا بالله صدق الله العلي العظيم. One of the issues that has become quite prevalent in many of our communities and amongst many individuals who consider themselves to be adherents of the Islamic tradition, who consider themselves to be religious and to be pious, one of the issues that has come up, unfortunately, is that some individuals and some communities end up expressing a state of being judgmental, meaning that when individuals see a member in the community or society make a mistake, for instance, when it comes to their acts of worship, a person may be in the masjid praying in a way where they may make a mistake or two, they may not recite something correctly, they might make a mistake during one of the actions. Or a sister, for instance, her hijab may not be perfect. There may be a flaw when it comes to her hijab or her appearance. And so on and so forth. And there are many examples. When a mistake is seen, unfortunately, sometimes there are individuals who attempt to correct this mistake, but do so in a very judgmental and condescending manner. And instead of encouraging the person to fix the mistake, they make the situation worse by pushing the person away and discouraging them even further. There tends to be within some people and some communities the what is known as the holier-than-thou attitude, that I am holier than you are, I am more pious than you are, I am more religious than you are, and I am better than you are. And unfortunately, this sense of arrogance that is prevalent among some individuals. And as a result, many people express this sense of religious obnoxiousness, being obnoxious because he or she is religious, or because he or she perceives him or herself to be religious. And the reason, perhaps, why some people exhibit such behavior is because when we come to our tradition, the Islamic tradition, we notice that there is a great deal of emphasis on giving advice, on encouraging others, on the concept of al-amr bil-ma'roof wa nahi anil munkar, enjoining good and forbidding evil. For instance, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, وَالْمُؤْمِنُونَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ بَعْضُهُمْ أَوْلِيَاءُ بَعْضٍ. And the believing men and the believing woman, they are what? They are awliya, they are guardians over one another. They guard one another, they protect one another. يَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. And part of this guardianship and protection is that altogether they enjoin one another to do good, and they forbid and discourage one another from doing evil and doing bad. And so there's an emphasis on advice, on teaching, on counseling people, on encouraging people, on showing them the right way and directing them away from the wrong path. The Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin, he says in the hadith, إِنَّ أَعْضَمَ النَّاسِ مَنْزِلَةً عِنْدَ اللَّهِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. Those who have the highest rank and status in the eyes of God on the Day of Judgment are whom? أَمْشَاهُمْ فِي أَرْضِهِ بِالنَّصِيحَةِ لِخَلْقِهِ. Those who give the most advice, those who care about others and they express advice and counsel to others, and they do so plentifully, they do so in a large manner. They're always giving advice to others. And so there's an emphasis on giving advice, on trying to guide people, on enjoining good, on forbidding evil. And as a result, sometimes some individuals, because of this, because this is the path that they would like to take, because they would like to be considered from those who encourage others towards good, they tend to be obnoxious. They tend to be condescending, and they tend to be judgmental of others when they see a deficiency and they see a problem. We know that the Quran tells us, yes, give advice, teach people, but that there's a certain etiquette, there's a certain way. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أُدْعُ إِلَىٰ سَبِيلِ رَبِّكَ بِالْحِكْمَةِ وَالْمَوْعِظَةِ الْحَسَنَةِ. Call to the way of your Lord, doing what? Using a certain etiquette, a certain technique, بِالْحِكْمَةِ, first and foremost, in wisdom, showing wisdom. And then the second is وَالْمَوْعِظَةِ الْحَسَنَةِ, good exhortation, good advice, humble advice, positive and encouraging advice. So use wisdom and use good advice. This is the way that we are encouraged to call people to the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So there are some steps and some ways that I think if we adopt and we adhere to and remember, they will limit the amount of behavior that is judgmental and condescending towards others. And I'd like to mention a few today. One, brothers and sisters, is to recognize that not everyone who is religious or pious today was always religious and pious. That not everyone falls from the sky being this pious and very devout and adherent person. And also to recognize, in addition, that being religious and being pious now does not necessarily guarantee that you will continue to do so until the end of your life. In fact, when we look at history, we notice that history shows us there were certain individuals who began and came from a background of complete darkness, and they were able to fully transform themselves into what? Into good. One example is that of Al-Hur ibn Yazid al-Riyahi. Right? We've all heard of Al-Hur. Al-Hur was one of the commanders of the Umayyad army on the eve of Ashura. He was the commander of the troops that did not allow Imam Hussein and his family and companions to enter into Kufa. Instead, he did what? He redirected them towards the land of Karbala. He did not allow them to enter Kufa and took them specifically towards Karbala. Historians, they tell us that on the eve of Ashura, Hur did what? Hur stood there and he asked himself. He evaluated himself. He said, what do I want to do? I'm standing between heaven and hell. On the one hand, here, this is the grandson of the Prophet, peace be upon him. On the other hand, Yazid has promised me what? He has promised me, you know, governorship of Ray. He has promised me wealth and fame and status and so on. And so he's deciding, he doesn't know which route to take, but in the end he decides what? He decides to take the path of truth. He decides to go towards Imam Hussein alayhi salam. And in fact, he tells the Imam, he says, "Oh my master, I have come to seek forgiveness. Do you think that Allah will forgive me?" Imam Hussein said, "If you seek forgiveness sincerely, yes, of course, Allah will forgive you." And until this day, Al-Hur ibn Yazid al-Riyahi is remembered every single year. And he will be continued to be remembered until the end of time. Because he transformed himself sincerely. And on the other hand, history also gives us examples of individuals who lived pious lives, who lived righteous lives for many, many years, but in the end, their destination was what? Was disaster. They destroyed themselves before leaving this life. There is a very famous story, some of you may have heard it, a very famous story found in some Islamic sources, of history sources and tradition, about a monk, a man by the name of Barsisa, who was known to be living during the time of Bani Israel, and he was very well known for his piety, a very pious man. And so the story goes that there were three brothers and they had a sister, and they wanted to travel, and so they did not want to leave their sister alone. So they asked the community members, they said, "Who can we leave our sister with?" They told them, "The best person to leave your sister with is whom? Is Barsisa, this very pious man, the monk who's devout." And so the brothers, they approached this man, they told him, at first he refused, but then later on they told him, "Listen, she's sick, she's ill, and we need someone to protect her. We can't leave her completely alone." So he said, "Okay." The story is long, but basically what ended up happening was Shaytan, he ended up doing what? Deceiving Barsisa, who had spent his entire life in worship, into doing what? Into committing adultery with this woman. And then afterwards, when he did so, she ended up conceiving. This caused the problem to be even bigger. He became more afraid. So he ended up killing her and burying her. When her brothers, they came back, they came and they asked him, they told him, "Barsisa, we are here for our sister, where is she?" What does he answer? What does he say? He told them, "I don't know. I was, you know, busy worshiping and praying and, you know, secluding myself to devotion. I don't know what happened, you know. Your sister," and he made up a story. In the end, his plan was known. The historians, they tell us that he was taken to court and he was commanded to be executed. And as a result, the shaytan, before this man's execution, the shaytan appeared before him and he told him, "Listen, look at the mess that you've got yourself into. There is no way that you can get out of this except one way. And I have the solution, I have the answer. All you need to do is to denounce God and submit to me and I'll take care of you." The man, he saw himself, he's in a situation where he's facing death. So he said, "Yes." And in the end, he ended up dying. Shaytan told him, "I have nothing to do with you." And in fact, the Quran tells us that on the Day of Judgment, those people who they followed Satan, they followed evil, they will go and they will look up to Satan and tell him, "You know, we followed you. Now you're supposed to take care of us." On that day, Shaytan will say what? He will say, I have nothing to do with you. I did not force you. You came and you followed me. You took the wrong path. And I can't save you now, I can't help you now. And so history gives us examples of those who came from darkness into complete light, into a positive transformation, and also vice versa. Those who lived long lives of sincerity but ended up in a very disastrous destination and end. And this, brothers and sisters, has to remind us that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is most merciful and most compassionate. Those who are sincere, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides them towards the truth. Individuals such as Hur, who were sincere, even though they did a lot of bad things, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided them because of their sincerity. And it also is a reminder for us who consider ourselves to be religious and pious and so on, that just by adhering to the principles of faith alone, without sincerity, is not a guarantee that we will be saved. It's not a guarantee that we will be successful. And thus, we have to continuously act and live with sincerity. And we have to pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep us always on the right path. This is why the short but very important dua is important. When we say, Allahumma ja'al awaqiba umurina khayra. O our Lord, make our destination good. Allow us to continue to be good, but make our final destination, before we leave this life, make our record good and our destination good. So this is number one. Number one is that we have to recognize this difference. Number two, in having the ability to limit judgmental behavior towards other and being condescending towards other, is to remember our own sins and our own shortcomings. Sometimes, many people, they are quick to point out the mistakes and faults of others, but they are also quick to forget their own faults, their own mistakes. After all, no one is perfect. Everyone has a lacking, a shortcoming, a mistake here or there. And so we are encouraged, instead of going out and pointing to the faults of people and the mistakes of people, to place our effort in doing what? In rectifying ourselves. Some people, they even go further, to go and look for people's faults. Not that he or she sees someone make a mistake and they're judgmental towards them, but they go on what I call fault-finding missions. They go on missions to find people's faults, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اجْتَنِبُوا كَثِيرًا مِنَ الظَّنِّ إِنَّ بَعْضَ الظَّنِّ إِثْمٌ. O you who believe, avoid much suspicion, most suspicion. Why? Because some suspicion is wrong, some suspicion is evil. Here, what is interesting to point out, Allah says, avoid most suspicion, but only some of this suspicion is prohibited. Because some of it, it might be real. When we suspect something bad about someone and we go and we investigate, it might turn out to be real. Okay, and some of it is fake. That which is fake is, of course, it's prohibited. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, avoid most suspicion so that you don't fall into this trap where you're suspicious of people and it's not true. What? And then Allah says, وَلَا تَجَسَّسُوا, and do not spy on people. Do not go looking for their faults. Instead, spend your efforts and time on fixing our own faults. And then finally, the third is that this judgmental behavior that some people express stems from a state of arrogance. Arrogance. Some people, they like to play the role of God. They like to play the role of God to judge people. This person, he's definitely going to heaven. This person, he's going to hell. As if there's nothing better to do in this world than hand out free boarding passes. This person gets a boarding pass to heaven, this person gets a boarding pass to hell. This person, and we put them in classes sometimes. This person on his way to hell, he's on the economy class. This person is, you know, business class. He's going faster. He's going, you know, before. And so this is very unfortunate. This stems from a state of arrogance. And we know that arrogance is one of the worst spiritual diseases that we can have. The Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, he says, "Inna abadakum yawm al-qiyamati minni," the most distant person away from me, from the Prophet on the Day of Judgment, is whom? Al-thartharun wa humul mustakbirun. The braggers. And those are the ones who are arrogant. Those who are arrogant, and we have other traditions that say that a person who has even the slightest amount of arrogance in their heart doesn't enter into the paradise. It's one of the worst diseases. It's truly one of the worst diseases. And many scholars have said that arrogance really stems from what? It's a product of a certain personal deficiency or weakness that a person has, and as a result, they attempt to compensate. Psychologists, they call it compensation, that a person has a weakness within them, a deficiency within them, and so they try to compensate for this deficiency by establishing or expressing arrogance, a sense of arrogance. And this is exactly what Imam Sadiq alayhi salam says in the hadith. He says that one of the major reasons why people exhibit arrogance is because they have a weakness. They're trying to overcome a personal deficiency, a personal weakness. Expressing judgmental behavior, being condescending and obnoxious towards others, is one of the worst things that we can do because it results from arrogance. In our attempt to cause people to become, you know, the inhabitants of heaven, right? If I'm trying to fix this person's mistake, whether it's the way that they pray or the way that they, you know, conduct themselves, we're trying to make them better Muslims. In my attempt to make this person an inhabitant, a person of heaven, if I do so in an arrogant and condescending and judgmental manner, I am risking what? Barring myself from being from the inhabitants of heaven. And so it's very important for us to keep this in mind. However, brothers and sisters, this does not mean that we do not give advice to others. Because there's a trend, especially more nowadays, that I avoid giving any advice to any of my friends, anyone else. Why? Because of one of two things. Either because I fear being judgmental, because when I do so, I fear I might say it or do it in a manner that is judgmental and condescending, or that I'm perceived to be judgmental, that people will say, oh, look at this guy. You know, he thinks he's so religious, he's so pious, now he's teaching others. And so as a result, many people, they end up doing what? Not giving advice to people, being quiet, not saying anything. They see something wrong, but they don't say anything because they are afraid of either being perceived judgmental, being perceived as being judgmental or acting judgmental. And this is wrong because the Quran and the Islamic tradition, it tells us that as a community of believers that we are guardians and we are protectors of one another. That when we give advice, this is a result of what? Of our care. Because we care about our brothers and sisters, this is why we give them advice. And so it's important for both the person that is giving the advice and the person that is receiving the advice to understand the significance of giving advice. That we do not completely deny and dismiss counseling others and encouraging others because we are afraid to be perceived judgmental or we are afraid to act in a way that is judgmental. In regards to a person giving advice, the Prophet says there's a simple etiquette, very simple etiquette. The Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, he says, لِيَنْصَحَ الرَّجُلُ مِنْكُمْ أَخَاهُ كَنَصِيحَتِهِ لِنَفْسِهِ When you give advice to your brother or sister in faith, do so in a way that you would like to be given advice. If you don't appreciate someone in public humiliating you and saying, hey, you don't know how to pray, you did this wrong, your hijab is terrible, you know, you're disrespectful, you have no clue, you don't know this, you don't know that. If you don't appreciate it for yourself, then don't do it to others. If you want people to respect you, if you make a mistake, to take you aside in private and to sincerely admonish you and give you advice, then do that to others. It's very simple. Treat people the way that you want to be treated, even when giving advice and counseling others. And for the recipient of advice, Amir al-Mu'mineen, Imam Ali alayhi salam, he says, طُوبَى لِمَنْ أَطَاعَ نَاصِحًا يَهْدِي He says, good for the person, glad tidings, and good for the person who listens to the person who is giving him sincere advice. Because unfortunately, many times, whether we as children to our parents, or siblings, or husband, or wife, or, you know, parents, or what have you. Many cases, unfortunately, when someone tries to give me advice, I feel as if the person is humiliating me. Oh, who's this person to tell me? This person is younger than me. This person is, you know, my child. My parents have no idea what they're talking about. This is my brother. This is my sister, you know. And so the problem is that we dismiss advice. And sometimes it's very sincere and very pure advice, Because we don't want people teaching me how to live my life. Because I already know how to live my life. And this is very prevalent, you know, with the younger generation, but even the elder generation. Sometimes, some who are not willing to listen to any advice whatsoever. Imam Ali alayhi salam says, if someone sincerely comes to you and wants to counsel you and teach you, listen to that person. Take that person's advice, especially if it's something that is beneficial for you. And thus, I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us all the capacity to express love and compassion, to be supportive of one another, and to encourage one another to be good adherents of our religion and to have strong faith and iman. Wa akhiru da'wana and alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Wal asr. Inna al-insana lafi khus illa ladhina amanu wa amilu salihati wa tawasaw bil haqqi wa tawasaw bil sabr.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين نحمده ونسبحه ونقدسه على آلائه ونعمائه ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن سيدنا محمدا عبده ورسوله اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد أرسله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله اللهم صل وسلم وبارك وترحم على محمد وآل محمد كأفضل ما صليت وسلمت وباركت وترحمت على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد وصل اللهم وسلم على أوصيائه وخلفائه وأهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين وعلى علي أمير المؤمنين وقائد الغر المحجلين وعلى البضعة الطاهرة فاطمة الزهراء سيدة نساء العالمين وعلى سبطي نبي الرحمة وإمامي الهدى الحسن والحسين سيدي شباب أهل الجنة وعلى أئمة المسلمين علي بن الحسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي والخلف الهادي المهدي أجل الله تعالى فرجه الشريف وجعلنا من أنصاره وأعوانه عباد الله أوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله عز وجل ولزوم أمره قال الله تعالى في محكم كتابه الكريم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ألم تر كيف ضرب الله مثلا كلمة طيبة كشجرة طيبة أصلها ثابت وفرعها في السماء تؤتي أكلها كل حين بإذن ربها ويضرب الله الأمثال للناس لعلهم يتذكرون آمنا بالله صدق الله العلي العظيم
Historians tell us that either the 8th or the 10th day of Rabi'ul Akhir or Rabi'ul Thani, a day like either tomorrow or tomorrow's the 8th or in a couple of days the 10th, is the day which marks the birth of the 11th Imam of the school of Ahlul Bayt, Al-Imam Al-Hasan Al-Askari alayhi salam, who was born in the year 232 after Hijrah. And historians tell us that the Imam, just like his father and just like many of his forefathers, lived in a very repressive and a very difficult time during the time of the Abbasis, who especially towards the Imams of Ahlul Bayt and the families of Ahlul Bayt, who were very oppressive and repressive. Although in some instances, publicly, they would show support, publicly they would honor, but in fact, privately and in reality, they expressed a lot of hatred and animosity towards the Imams of Ahlul Bayt. And so historians tell us that the Imam, he grew up in a very difficult time in Samarra, Surra Man Ra'a. And the Imam, in fact, lived for a very short period of time. Historians tell us that the Imam lived for 28 years. That he was 28 years old when he achieved martyrdom, when he left this life. And this, brothers and sisters, and I've said this before,
when we come across certain occasions when we celebrate the birth of a family, an imam of Ahlul Bayt, or very important person in history, or we commemorate their martyrdom or their death, it's a time for us to reflect. It's a time for us to think about how this personality lived his or her life, how they conducted themselves. And so for me especially, I ask myself about this great imam who achieved such a great heritage, intellectual heritage, and ethical heritage and legacy, an imam who died at the age of 28 years old, had accomplished this and so much more. And so I have to ask myself, as a follower of this imam, what am I doing to relate to this imam? Yes, there are many things that we may not be able to do that are specific to the life of the imams. However, as followers of these individuals, there are many lessons that we can learn from their lives that we can try to implement in our lives. And although the life of the imam is filled with a lot of production, I'd just like to mention in a couple of minutes one saying of the imam to reflect upon for a few moments. The imam has many beautiful short maxims. One of the really powerful ones, Al-Imam Al-Askari alayhi salam, he says, قَلْبُ الْأَحْمَقِ فِي فَمِهِ وَفَمُ الْحَكِيمِ فِي قَلْبِهِ. He says, the heart of a fool resides in his mouth, and the mouth of a sage, a wise person, resides in his heart. And this is very powerful. Here the imam, he's telling us that each and every one of us, we've been equipped with intellect. Heart doesn't necessarily mean the physical heart that we have, but it's a reference to intellect. It's a reference to the place where we have faith, and that we reason, and that we have intellect, and we think. Here, the imam says that the difference between a fool and a wise person is not that they both have brains, that one has a brain and the other doesn't, that one can, you know, reason and the other, or that one can speak, one has a tongue and can speak and the other, no, they both do. But the difference is that when a fool speaks, you can tell that his expressions, they originate from his tongue and not from his heart, not from his mind. He has not thought about what he wants to say. And many people, they live their lives like this. They're quick to say things, they're quick to make judgments, they're quick to react without thinking through of both the short-term and the long-term consequences. And on the other hand, there are those who are considered wise, who before they say or do anything, they think about it. And this is the difference that the imam is making in this short maxim. There's a famous hadith that says that 1 hour of contemplation and thinking is more valuable than 70 years of worship without reflection. Because just like I mentioned in the story of Barsisa, you can worship for 50, 60, 70 years, but if there's no contemplation, if you're not thinking and pondering about the object of your worship and the reason why you are worshiping, what can happen? It can crumble. It's just a set of physical actions. There's no essence to it. And so it's important for us to keep this message in mind. I congratulate you all, my dear brothers and sisters, on this occasion, and I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to lead lives that truly, in a way that we are truly able to implement the teachings of the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, and the Imams. Wa akhiru da'wana and alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Wal asr, innal insana lafi khusr. Illa alladhina amanu wa amilu s-salihati wa tawasaw bil haqqi wa tawasaw bil sabr. وصلى الله على محمد وأهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين